President of the Legislative Council. Mr. Ji Huaidek, I request a quorum count.
朱海迪議員.
Mr. 朱海迪. Thank you, President. This morning, we resume our discussion on the resolution in respect of the legal aid in criminal cases amendment rules, and also the arrangement to increase the fees for several schemes in the provision of legal aid. Yesterday, I heard from some members that we can summarize our discussion through certain threats or the certain issues. And I would like to provide a framework here. And that is the first point, the fees are too low, and they want to refer to the market. So how is the market how does the market determine the rates? I think it has to do with the ratio between the number of lawyers to the general population. In 2013, Singapore conducted a survey on this subject. For every 1,000 people in Singapore, they have 0.83 lawyer. Our ratio is higher, which is 1.16. But if we look at the corresponding race in UK, in London, Australia, and New York, it's 2.64, 3.15, and 8.37, respectively. If the ratio of a lawyer to people remains at a lower at a rate lower than other major cities, the fees demanded by lawyers will not be low, will not be any lower. This is a semi-restrictive market. The two legal professional bodies and the number of law students are such that it is not a market with free access. Now the government has proposed a new set of scale of fees for criminal legal aid lawyers. Are they too low? I have some personal experience in utilizing the duty lawyer service and also criminal legal aid in my appeal case. But the lawyers works a sort of a pro bono, on a pro bono basis. The fees are not as good as they would otherwise have been paid. It was 5 to 6 years ago. I checked now that according to the scale of fees, if it's an appeal case about a magistracy's case for a barrister or for counsel, on an hourly basis, it's $1,910. After the adjustment, it would be $1,980, or an increase of $70. If you have some experience in engaging a lawyer in private practice, whether you know that whether it's 1910, 1980, you know that it's very much lower than what you have to pay if you do it in the private market. And they are also going to ask for $35,000 for the first day of appearance in an appeal case. But under the legal aid scale, it's just $14,000, not $690. So there is going to have a problem. We are going to have a problem in criminal legal aid. There are fewer lawyers available in Hong Kong than in other cities. And for a long, long time, the government has been paying these lawyers a lower fee, 60% of the normal rates. So for those who lack means, who are facing criminal prosecution, they will not get the best service.
去到呢度咧，陳志全議員咧，其實我聽翻尋日嘅咁多位同事發
，Mr. Chan Chi-jin put it in great detail yesterday on ways to improve the system. If we rely on CPIC, she thinks that it's not appropriate.
Because CCPIC is for working out household expenditure, so the expenses of legal practice and that of a household are very different. And then a member compared this to allowances to members, where many of us are of the view that if we use a CPIC to assess the allowances payable to members is inappropriate, because in renting ward offices and employing assistance, well, the expenses are not like household expenses. So Mr. Ray Chen proposed another way of calculating it, and that is we should have an indicator that more closely mirror the actual expenses of legal practices. I will not elaborate on his proposal, but I think it has a major flaw. Although CPIC is problematic when used as a basis for reviewing the fees, well, he talked about the actual expenses of league of law firms. I think it's just talking about the rate of adjustment. Why is this problematic? Because in 2003, the Finance Committee of the Council approved that the criminal legal aid fees should be downwardly adjusted because of the poor economy back then with deflation. And then at the same discussion, it was approved that the authority to review the fees be delegated to the Director of Administration with reference to changes in CPIC during the reference period. I would have thought that few members would be interested in such a discussion, but it turns out to be different. Ms. Margaret, a former a member of this council, raised a point. She said that to review the fees in accordance with the CCPI changes during the reference period was not controversial, but the problem is the various services But the problem lies with the basis for various services provided by lawyers. So this issue was already raised in 2003. I'm not arguing with you whether the rates were, the increase in rate was proper or not. In fact, the most controversial point is the baseline. If the baseline is reasonable, then the review or the rate of increase may be slower. It's just like our civil servants. Usually, senior civil servants have a lower rate of pay adjustment, but we don't see them coming out to protest. The reason being, of course, they are not allowed to strike. But then another reason is because their basic salary is already rather high. So although the rate of increase is not as much as the other ranks, it's still okay. In 2003, there was an argument that the baseline should be reviewed first before it came to ask FC to delegate the power to conduct the biannual review to the Director of Administration. Ms. Emily Lau moved a motion to adjourn, but it was defeated. In moving the motion to adjourn, Ms. Emily Lau reflected the features or characteristics of this debate. Members may think that this is not a very complicated matter and you shouldn't spend so much time on it. Now, the problem is the government hasn't presented to us complicated issues for discussion. So we have to take this opportunity to draw into points when we really have the opportunity to do so. So at least we have exposed or we have discovered that the problem first started in 1992. The crux of the debate is whether we should veto this proposal to revise the fees. In exchange, we have the opportunity to ask the administration to come back and conduct a review of the basic the baseline rates, which was first requested more than 20 years ago. So I can imagine counsels who helped me in my lawsuit using criminal legal aid fees would not oppose. I think he would not mind having $70 more or less in an hour, and that we should give up this opportunity. So I think we should grasp this opportunity. Many members, including Mr. Holden Chow, said yesterday that the current system was problematic. So when we vote on this item, can we vote it down to pressurize the government? I don't think this is going to harm the legal sector because the base fees are really, really far too low. And lastly, just two more short points. I hope you allow me to go on. In a criminal lawsuit, my experience is the first step is a pitfall for many defendants. That is, as soon as a person is arrested and detained in a police station, at that stage, there is no government subsidy to hire a lawyer to help at all. Now, this is not my personal experience, but I once helped someone who was accused or suspected of engaging in illegal employment in Hong Kong. When It would need me $3,000-$4,000 to hire a lawyer to help. Fortunately, I was able to find somebody to help. If there was no duty lawyer available, he would not have known that in Hong Kong he would have the right to silence and various rights. So even though you grant him legal aid afterwards, if in the police station he didn't know how to protect himself, then harm has already been done. So your time's up. Mr. Lam Chek Ting. President, we are all elected members of this council, and I was a law enforcement officer in the past. So I think I have more to say on this legal aid on amendment to the Criminal Procedure Ordinance. The DFJ once sent officers explained to my department, telling us that the threshold of prosecution was very high because the defendant would be under extreme economic and financial and psychological pressure, and then the DFJ would investigate case very cautiously. The role of a law enforcement agency is to find out the facts and to gather evidence. Whether a defendant should be convicted is the role of the court. To find out the facts and uphold justice is not just the responsibility of our law enforcement agencies and DFJ. Our legal system, our legal aid system are also indispensable to the whole system. In Hong Kong, we have the duty lawyers scheme, and we've also got lawyers employed by legal aid. I believe our members have commented on the impact on the rights of defendants. I will comment on the impact on the prosecution by these systems. First, rights of defendants. Because resources under legal aid are limited, what are the impacts? As I said, defendants are subject to extreme financial and mental pressure. Most people in Hong Kong are not that well off to be able to cope with a lawsuit. If they employ their own lawyers, they have to spend at least hundreds of or even millions of dollars, even an astronomical figure, on hiring lawyers. So if a member of the public is faced with a lawsuit at a magistrate's court, he would employ the assistance of a duty lawyer. Well, you know, in each magistrate court, there will be dozens of defendants waiting, and then the duty lawyer will only have 10 minutes or so to look at the charge and give him some legal advice. And then on first mention, he would be advised not to plead and wait for the second time. But on many occasions, the duty lawyer would tell the defendant directly that you don't have a case, so you might as well plead guilty. Even though the defendant might tell him that, well, I did not give this statement voluntarily, but the duty lawyer would not have enough time to go through the case and come to such a recommendation. Many colleagues, including myself, are providing legal advice in our ward offices, and this is what we have heard from many members of the public when they come for help. So is it true that in many cases they have no case at all? But when I studied the statement very often, I came to the conclusion that perhaps further legal advice should be sought. Because in some cases, whether a cautioned statement can be admissible in court depends on two factors. First, whether the statement was given on coercion or by lure. So if it is not given on a voluntary basis, then even though the cautioned statement was signed, should not be admissible in court. To see whether the statement was given voluntarily by the defendant, we cannot make a judgment by simply listening to the defendant's side of the story. For instance, we should check the notebooks of the law enforcement agencies and law enforcement officers who arrested him. There could be a few. Notebooks, and then we should also look at the arrest and detention sheet to see who have approached him in the process. And there might be a written cautioned statement, there may be more than one, and there may be a video and recordings of the interviews. So all these have to be reviewed very carefully before we can judge whether it was given, the cautioned statement was given voluntarily by the defendant. In many cases, criminal prosecution would rely on the statement of omission by the defendants.
But do duty lawyers have sufficient time to go through all the information of all these people before comprehensive legal advice is given to the client to advise them as to whether to plead guilty or not? It sounds technical, but it is about a person's future. If the person pleads guilty and convicted, it's not just about being sent to prison. There will be a criminal conviction, which in turn will adversely affect that person's future. So it should not be taken lightly. I mentioned that, well, it's the first court appearance. Well, plead not guilty and wait till the next time. But the thing is, do you have sufficient time in the second appearance? Not necessarily. It depends on the fees charged. If there is not enough time, then the lawyer would look at the case to see if there is a chance of an acquittal. And if there is sufficient information, there is no need to even go to the second appearance, because from the first appearance to the second appearance, it takes time and there are resources involved. So inevitably, there will be a backlog of cases in a legal system which affects the operation of Hong Kong courts. We have received complaints from lawyers participating in the duty lawyer service. You may say, well, that's a fee, take it or leave it. Yes, they may choose to take it. But a lot of lawyers take the cases thinking that is their way to contribute to society. Say, for example, they are client. These people have met clients who deserve a bit of help. But do you take advantage of lawyers' kindness to exploit them? It's not the case that we don't have the resources. We have a huge surplus in Hong Kong. And you're not paying lawyers more than they deserve. I just want you to pay them a reasonable fee level. Lawyers told me that, they have a lot of expenditure incurred. Say, for example, an increasing in prices, expenditure in their chambers, and also salary. The low fees paid under the duty lawyer scheme will affect their professional service. Some lawyers complain to us that they don't mind accepting a lower pay. However, the legal aid department will not pay them 6 months after the completion of the case. And sometimes they are paid part of it, and they don't know when the remaining amount will be paid to them. That is really strange. Why do they withhold part of the payment instead of paying the lawyers in full? Because it's been over 6 months after the completion of the case. I think Mr. Lau Kong Wah, the secretary, will have to ask departments to find out why. It's not easy to apply for legal aid. If you have some savings, say for example $200,000, then they will have to bear part of the cost. The legal aid will ask them to go through the means test and may ask them to bear a large amount of cost. So some of them will go unrepresented. And that is not good, because I have seen a lot of cases with unrepresented litigants, and they have made a mess of the entire proceedings. And I've also seen cases when lawyers are engaged at a very low fee, and the quality of the lawyers is so poor that it affects the proceedings. When I was working in the ICAC, I have come across a barrister that had to use five or six questions instead of one to get to one point. And the court was annoyed. And the barrister said to me that, the fees he was paid was not enough for him to do anything at all. And at that time I thought, why did you not refuse to take the case up if you think you're paid so little? And some people would think that, it's there anyway, I may as well take it. So it will affect the quality of the case. The case could have been completed with one or two days of hearing, and instead is dragged on for five or six. This affects the protection given to Hong Kong people. The basic law states very clearly that under Article 25 that all Hong Kong residents shall be equal before the law, and Article 35 that Hong Kong residents have the right to confidential legal advice, access to courts, a choice of lawyers for timely protection of their lawful rights. All these articles clearly state that Hong Kong people enjoyed basic rights to legal protection. But the reality in Hong Kong is that if you have money, you can buy more equality. Poor people have to put up with meager legal service available. And I think the people who suffer most are those who are neither rich nor poor. When they have to apply for legal aid, they realize that it's very difficult. They have to engage solicitors or barristers, and they have to pay an astronomical amount in cost. A lot of people face tremendous pressure financially and psychologically as a result. That is not fair. When I was working in the ICAC, I remember a case. That morning, the hearing was due to start, and someone received a phone call to say that, well, the hearing could not go on because the defendant did not appear. Police officers found the defendant. Defendant committed suicide. Perhaps people can't feel the pressure defendants face. But sometimes when they can't put up with the tremendous financial pressure brought by litigation, it won't be surprising that they choose to take their own lives. Mr. Eunice Ho, today we're here to talk about the legal aid in criminal cases amendment rules 2017. It's not controversial, but I don't understand how come some other members have gone off a tangent. The principle is there. We all agree with it. Some people talk about quality. Of course, today we're here because of the monetary amount. There will be an adjustment of 4%. First, I need to declare that I am a practicing solicitor and I'm also the former president of the Law Society, and I was once involved in the discussion of fee adjustments. Now there is a proposal of 4%. The trade finds it just acceptable. About a decade ago, there were discussions saying that the criminal legal aid fees were so low and so different from the market rate. And at that time, there was a high-profile gesture to object to this meager amount. After discussions with the administration, a decision was made to take it step by step. The adjustment for 2017 started on the basis formed a decade ago, and there would be adjustment once every three or four years. And I don't think that is sufficient. It's very unfair to practitioners. They work very hard for their clients, and they try to drag this adjustment on, and Eddie Ju said that it should be vetoed to bring about a comprehensive review. I don't oppose to a comprehensive review. I don't oppose to a more fair allocation. Well, the administration has a lot of money, and it needs to be used wisely. This proposed resolution should be endorsed as soon as possible. Lam Chuk Ting said that, well, a barrister will ask 5 or 6 questions instead of one. That itself is filibustering. If you think that filibustering is bad, then you as a legislator should be swift. Why do we have to drag this proposed resolution on for so many hours? Where is our efficiency? Members of the public criticize us because it's already late, and you try to delay it for another few years. You drag it on for a few meetings. When you criticize lawyers for asking 5-6 questions instead of one, and spending 5 or 6 days of hearing instead of one to try to get more money, then you need to look in at the mirror to see if you're doing the same thing. This is a very simple resolution. It should be endorsed as soon as possible. If you think that there is, something wrong with the legal basis, raise this in the AJLS panel. But that wasn't done there. And Eddie Ju is a member of the panel. He did not say anything. And yet he said all those things here. And what he said reflects his quality. We expect high quality from our lawyers. And it's not because they have done a lot of work. When you talk about the ratio in the US and the UK, we have 7.3 million people, about 11,000 solicitors, and about 1,300 barristers. So we have one lawyer to every six or seven people. Every year there are 360 people joining the trade. In the past decade, there are altogether an additional 3,600 people. Yes. Well, we have under 12,000, but in the past decade, there was an increase of 3,600. It's not just by adding more people to make ourselves feel satisfied. We talk about equality. What is the caliber of the people joining the trade? And they will be serving the public. The same goes for legislators. What is the quality of legislators serving the public? They do one thing and say another. I think it's double standard. I use less than 6 minutes to show my support to this proposed resolution. Secretary, I hope that, there should be more frequent review to narrow the difference between the fees level of legal aid and the market rate, and there should be increase in manpower to serve the public. Thank you.
Does any other member wish to speak? Mr. Kuang Chun-Yu. President, this morning's session is about the legal aid in criminal cases amendment rules. We all know that this is about a 4% increase to the fees in line with CPIC. Mr. Junis Ho is angry that we should not ask the same questions time and again. But this is not simple, because past adjustments were all based on CPIC starting from 2004. We have been following 8.3%, 12, another adjustment in line with CPIC. And this is a problem. The work pressure of legal aid lawyers are receiving fees which are not in line with the market fees. So we should have a proper discussion here to follow up, as Mr. Lim Chuk Teng has said. If we engage a less experienced lawyer, one question would become 5 to 6. Many legal aid lawyers are conscientious. I have met some very nice and good lawyers. But sometimes, because of the low fees, the quality is not as good as we expect. You know that they can only get a 7,500 for seeing a number of clients. Thank you.
請秘書點算人數。
SG, please count the number of members. Members, please be seated while the secretary does a head count. As the quorum bell has been rung for 15 minutes, and we do not have a quorum. In accordance with 17.2 of our ROP, I declare the meeting adjourned.